Good morning. Welcome to First Presbyterian. I'm Reverend Christy Kass. We are glad you are here to worship with us this morning. And I want to say a special hi to everyone who is listening on the radio. Everybody say hi to our friends listening on the radio.
Hi.
There you go. This week, as we continue our Summer at the Movie series, our movie this week is C.S. Lewis's The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. I'm so excited. A title of our message today is Rescue Plan. Just a few announcements this morning. Please fill out the connection card, as always, and leave it with your offering in the box in the back as you're leaving. I know we say this every week, but we truly appreciate your support in financing the ministry and the work that we do here at First Presbyterian. And we also appreciate your time in volunteering for our outreach projects. Speaking of our outreach projects, this is a busy time for the outreach that we do in the Hutchinson community. We have Convoy of Hope coming up on July 27th, and that is followed by our church work day, our annual church work day that we do at Lincoln McCandless School. That is on August 11th. That goes from 9 until noon. There will be no services on that day as we go to help get the classrooms ready for the new term. There will be a job available for everyone. Doesn't matter your age, your mobility, none of that matters. There's a job for everyone. We can find you a job in a class that you're comfortable with, so please sign up if you're able. We have, we need a huge team of people to make this happen. So there is a clipboard. What are we gonna pass those around? Are they in the back? Oh, he was asleep. Pass those around. Sign up. What did you say?
You woke me up, yeah.
Oh, I woke him, sorry. So pass those around, sign up if you are able. Again, this is August 11th in the morning from 9 until noon at Lincoln McCandless School. We do need a big team to help these teachers get their classrooms ready for the new school term. We're also asking for you to help support our Fill the Pantry at Lincoln McCandless for the new term. We have a list available of the needed food items. You can pick these up in the back as you're leaving. Please check the dates on the food just to make sure that they have a long shelf life. That's also very important. Your help in filling this food pantry was much appreciated last year. It made a huge difference. I don't think sometimes we realize that hunger can be a real issue in our own community, but it really is. And it's startling to realize just how many children go hungry in our own backyard. So your help in keeping the food pantry at Lincoln McCandless stocked is vital. So if you can help out with filling that, that would be great. You can pick up this form tells us what is mostly needed there, and that would be a wonderful help to us. That is all the announcements that I have this morning. So now, if you are able, please stand and join us as we sing our opening hymn, number 138, Holy, Holy, Holy.
Oh,
Please join me in our call to worship. God has set this day before us, a day set apart, a day of rest and praise. God has set our lives before us, a span of years in which we love and learn and serve. God has set God's seal upon hearts so that we might live fully in deep love. Let us worship God. Please be seated. Join with me in our prayer of confession, please. Christ, our peace, you promised to make us one new humanity, reconciling us to God and building us into a dwelling place for the Most High. Firm atop the of the apostles and prophets. Like the prophets before us, you have called us to be shepherds who both guide and comfort. Model for us how to be good shepherds, not those who scatter the sheep with errant advice and wayward words, but those who lead them beside still waters in the right paths for the sake of your holy name. Amen. And our assurance of pardon. We are blessed because he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. He has destined us in his love to be his sons and daughters through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
This morning's scripture lesson from the Old Testament is 2 Samuel chapter 7 verses 1 to 14 from the New International Version, talking about God's promise to David. After the king was settled in his palace and the Lord had given him rest from all his enemies around him, he said to Nathan the prophet, "Here I am living in a house of cedar while the ark of God remains a tent." Nathan replied to the king, "Whatever you have in mind, go ahead and do it, for the Lord is with you." But that night, the word of the Lord came to Nathan, saying, "Go and tell my servant David, this is what the Lord says. Are you the one to build me a house to dwell in? I have not dwelt in a house from the day I brought the Israelites up out of Egypt to this day. I have been moving from place to place with a tent as my dwelling. Wherever I have moved with all the Israelites, did I ever say to any of their rulers whom I commanded to shepherd my people Israel, why have you not built me a house of cedar? Now then, tell my servant David, this is what the Lord Almighty says. I took you from the pasture, from tending the flock, and appointed you ruler over my people Israel. I have been with you wherever you have gone, and I have cut off all your enemies from before you. Now I will make your name great, like the names of the greatest men on earth. And I will provide a place for my people Israel, and will plant them so that they can have a home of their own and no longer be disturbed. Wicked people will not oppress them anymore as they did at the beginning, and have done ever since the time I appointed leaders over my people Israel. I will also give you rest from all your enemies. The Lord declares to you that the Lord himself will establish a house for you. When your days are over and you rest with your ancestors, I will raise up your offspring to succeed you, your own flesh and blood, and I will establish his kingdom. He is the one who will build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be his father, and he will be my son. When he does wrong, I will punish him with a rod wielded by men, with floggings inflicted by humans. The New Testament reading is from Ephesians chapter 2, verses 11 through 22. This is talking about the Jews and Gentiles reconciled through Christ. Therefore, remember that formerly you who are Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised by those who call themselves the circumcision, which is done in the body by human hands, remember that at the time you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, and foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far away have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace. He has made the two groups one and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility. By setting aside in his flesh the law with its commands and regulations, his purpose was to create in himself one new humanity out of the two, thus making peace, and in one body to reconcile both of them to God through the cross by which he put to death their hostility. He came and preached peace to you who were far away and peace to those who were near. For through him, we both have access to the Father by one Spirit. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people and also members of his household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as a chief cornerstone. In him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him, you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. This is the word of the Lord.
Let's pray. Holy God, three in one, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we praise you for your goodness and your everlasting loving kindness. With the power of your word, you created the world and everything in it and fashioned us in your own image. In your word made flesh, you lived among us, taught us your way, and reconciled us to you. Through your living word, you continue to call us to obedience and service in the power of your Holy Spirit. Thank you, God, for the claim you put on our lives in baptism and the call to follow you throughout life. We pray for the wisdom of your Son's teachings to guide us in our actions, in what we say and do as followers of Jesus. May we always say and do what he has taught and shown us in his own life. Hear our prayers, O Lord. God of all creation, we pray for the world in which we live. God, you offer us a better way, but we continue to live in strife. We divide ourselves and look to our own interests. We become discouraged and think that we can't make a difference. Lord, show us how to live as a witness to your power, promise, and your love and your grace. Hear our prayers, O Lord. God of life, as the crowds carried their sick to Jesus with the hope of them being healed, we still carry our sick to you in our prayers. We pray for all for whom life is a struggle today because of illness, both those who are sick and those who give care. Bless those who are undergoing treatments, recovering from surgeries, facing new diagnoses, and those living with chronic conditions. May they know the peace of your life-giving spirit. We also pray for those who are preparing to cross over into their eternal reward and for their loved ones. Help us always to live as those who are prepared to die, so that when it is our time to die, we may go forth as those who are prepared to live in Christ Jesus. God, we offer these and all of our prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, who taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who have sinned against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
There's a prophecy that two sons of Adam and two daughters of Eve will appear to defeat the White Witch and put an end to this 100-year winter.
I think you've made a mistake. We're not heroes.
There's no mistake. Aslan is on the move.
We need your help.
I know, but understand. The future of Narnia rests on your courage.
If it's a war Aslan wants, it's a war he shall get.
Numbers far greater than our own.
Numbers do not win a battle.
No, but I bet they help.
Our third scripture reading this morning is from the book of Colossians, chapter 1, verses 3 through 14. We always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, when we pray for you, because we have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love you have for all God's people, the faith and love that spring from the hope stored up for you in heaven and about which you have already heard in the true message of the gospel that has come to you. In the same way, the gospel is bearing fruit and growing throughout the whole world, just as it has been doing among you since the day you heard it and truly understood God's grace. You learned it from Epaphras, our dear fellow servant, who is a faithful minister of Christ on our behalf, and who also told us of your love in the Spirit. For this reason, since the day we heard about you, we have not stopped praying for you. We continually ask God to fill you with the knowledge of his will through all the wisdom and understanding that the Spirit gives, so that you may live a life worthy of the Lord and please him in every way, bearing fruit in every good work, growing in the knowledge of God, being strengthened with all the power according to his glorious might, so that you may have great endurance and patience, and giving joyful thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of his holy people in the kingdom of light. For he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. This is the word of the Lord. To say that I've been looking forward to today's film is the biggest understatement since Noah said, "Looks like rain." As you may know, I'm a huge fan of C.S. Lewis, all of C.S. Lewis's writings, and a huge fan of all of the Chronicles of Narnia. And when The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe was made into the movie that came out in 2005, I didn't camp out overnight in order to be first in line to see it, but pretty close. And when the Occupy Wall Street movement was going on, Guy made a decal for my car that said, "Occupy Narnia." But when I sat down to write this sermon, I ran into a big old honking problem. It turns out that when you love a story as much as I love The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, and when a story has so many layers and is full of so much Christian imagery as this one, it is really hard to figure out what to say without running the risk of saying way too much and keeping you all here for 6 hours. But I know you won't mind, so. Why? I'm kidding. But I will start off by saying that if you haven't seen this film, you really should consider it. It is beautifully made. And I'll take it one step further. If you haven't read the book, you really should consider that as well. The whole Narnia series makes for great summer reading and winter reading and spring and fall reading. I'm sorry, I had to say it. Now, before we get into talking about the movie, about the story itself, I want to tell you a little bit about C.S. Lewis. Now, some of you may already know a lot about his life, and for others, this may be new information. But I think it's important to understand where Lewis was coming from when he wrote The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, because it puts everything into a different light when you understand his faith journey. Now, I'm kind of warning you now, I studied Lewis in depth, even to the point of taking undergraduate classes on his life and his works, but I will do my best to not just unload all of that on you here this morning. Now, C.S. Lewis was born in
the land of saints and scholars and Keith Neal in Belfast, Northern Ireland. Yeah.
Thank you.
There you go.
I was looking for the answer to just be Belfast. I should have known that. And he grew up in a religious home as one of two boys. And Jack, as Lewis called himself, was always close with his older brother, Warren. And the boys spent their time writing stories to saints and scholars. That just sank in, okay.
And me.
And you.
Yeah.
The boys spent their time writing stories to entertain themselves. And young Jack created a fantasy world that he called Boxin'. And it was an adventurous world full of talking animals that you can kind of see what this is a predecessor of. Probably the most significant event of Lewis's early life was the death of his mother when he was 9 years old. And Lewis says in his autobiography, Surprised by Joy, "With my mother's death, all settled happiness disappeared from my life. There was to be much fun, many pleasures, many stabs of joy, but no more of the old security. It was sea and island now. The great continent had sunk like Atlantis. Now at this point, he lost not only his mother, but also in effect his father. Albert Lewis, perhaps out of grief, withdrew emotionally and decided to send both sons off to boarding school. And Warren, the older brother, later wrote of his father's choice, "With his uncanny flair for making the wrong decision, my father had given us helpless children into the hands of a madman." Now, in case this sounds like children exaggerating about a teacher they didn't like, the fact is, the headmaster, a man they called Oldie, was later declared insane and the school was closed down. And it was during this period, Lewis attended church and attempted to take his religious beliefs seriously. He tried to pray every night, but he developed what he called a false conscience about it. He'd been told that it wasn't just enough to say your prayers, you have to think about what you're saying. So as soon as he'd finished his prayers each night, then he would ask himself, "Are you sure you were really thinking about what you were saying?" And then, of course, the answer was inevitably no. So then he would say his prayers again and again and again. And this led to insomnia and nightly torment. And as Lewis says, "Had I pursued the same road much further, I think I would have gone mad." Then when he was in his teens, after various dabblings with paganism and the occult and at other boarding schools, Lewis became an atheist and remained an atheist well into adulthood. But he always had a curious, brilliant mind, and he was a voracious reader. And over the years, one by one, the arguments that he had against the Christian faith became answered through his reading and his studies until, as he put it, and I love this quote, he felt the steady, unrelenting approach of him who I so earnestly desired not to meet. Finally, he says, one night he gave in, admitted that God was God, knelt and prayed. He describes himself that night as, quote, "the most dejected and reluctant convert in all England." Now, at that time, he only became a theist. He only admitted to a belief in God, but he began considering who Christ was and kind of sorting through some other religious views. Now, his conversion after that to Christianity was also completely unspectacular. He describes it in his book, Surprised by Joy, as happening, I love this story, happening on a day when he and a friend were going to visit the zoo, and they were on his friend's motorcycle, and Lewis was riding in the sidecar. "When we left for the zoo," Lewis writes, "I did not believe that Jesus Christ was the Son of God. And when we arrived at the zoo, I did." Nothing extraordinary had happened along the way, except that Jesus had met him there in that motorcycle sidecar. So C.S. Lewis went from quiet, bereaved, religiously obedient schoolboy to rebellious young man to staunch intellectual atheist, and then on to become one of the most respected and celebrated Christian writers of all time. One of the reasons that so many people turned to Lewis's writing when they're struggling in their own faith, or will give copies of his books to atheist friends who have begun to question whether Christianity might be of interest to them after all, is because Lewis understands. He has been there. Now, the appeal of C.S. Lewis's writings continues to be the way in which he combines reason and imagination. He argued that, and this is another direct quote, "Christianity, if false, is of no importance, and if true, of infinite importance. The one thing it cannot be is moderately important." And in one of his most used quotes of all time, Lewis said, "I believe in Christianity as I believe that the sun has risen, not only because I see it, but because by it I see everything else." Now, I gave you that background on C.S. Lewis this morning because it's important to understand his road from a young boy who struggled in his dark room at night because he wasn't sure he was saying his prayers right, to an intellectual adult who tried to reason and think his way both out of the Christian faith and then back into it, before finally evolving into the celebrated writer who unleashed the kind of creativity we see on display in The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. It always amuses me when critics say, you know, I think The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe might be about Christianity. And I think the character of Aslan is maybe supposed to represent Jesus. I always want a slow clap for those people for figuring that out. Lewis made no attempt to hide the Christian imagery he used in that story. Yes, it's possible to watch or read The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe as just a simple fantasy story, nothing more, nothing less. As I said before, the movie is beautifully made with gorgeous special effects and beautiful English scenery and a lovely soundtrack. So yes, it's possible to just enjoy the film on a surface level. But nobody has to dig very deep to understand the allegory. Lewis wasn't trying to disguise the Christian message in his story. In fact, it is a great example of how many creative ways there are to tell the salvation story of Jesus to a world that might find one of those ways interesting enough to actually listen. Now, I'm going to give you a quick overview of the story. It's about four siblings, Peter, Susan, Edmund, and Lucy Pevensey. And they're evacuated from London in 1940 to escape the Blitz. And they're sent to live with Professor Diggory Kirk at a large house in the English countryside where it's safe. And one day while she's exploring the house, Lucy goes into a wardrobe and discovers the magical world of Narnia. And just after she enters, she meets a faun named Tumnus. And he invites her to his cave for tea. And after a while, he admits to her that he had intended to report her to the White Witch, a false ruler of Narnia who has kept the land in perpetual winter. Always winter, but never Christmas, is what they say. But then he feels bad, and he decides not to turn Lucy in after all. And then he shows her the way back home through the wardrobe. Now, although Lucy's siblings initially don't believe her story about Narnia, because you can't always get back in. Sometimes it's there and sometimes it's not. And her brother Edmund, who is the bratty, troublemaker brother, everyone has that one sibling who's like that. Don't act like you don't know what I'm talking about. Edmund secretly follows her into the wardrobe one day, but he finds himself alone in a separate area of Narnia. And he meets the White Witch, who calls herself the Queen of Narnia. And the witch plies Edmund with a candy called Turkish Delight, they don't understand it either, and persuades him to bring his siblings to her with the promise that she will make him a prince. Now after this, Edmund reunites with Lucy and they return home. And Lucy tells him about the White Witch, and Edmund realizes that she's the woman he's met, and this makes him really cranky. So when they get back, he denies Narnia's existence to Peter and Susan, which upsets Lucy. So fast forward a little bit, and all four children get into Narnia together, but they find that Tumnus the Faun has been arrested for treason. Now, the children are befriended by Mr. and Mrs. Beaver, who we saw in the clip, and they are, in fact, talking beavers. And the beavers tell them of a prophecy that the White Witch's rule will end when two sons of Adam and two daughters of Eve sit on the four thrones of Cair Paravel, which is the capital of Narnia, and that Narnia's true ruler, a great lion named Aslan, is returning after several years of absence, and we'll go to the stone table. We'll come back to the stone table in a moment. So Edmund hears all this, and he sneaks away to the White Witch's castle, where he finds a courtyard filled with the witch's enemies that have been turned into stone statues. You think this would tip him off that she's not good, but no. Edmund tells the witch about Aslan's return, which is not news that she enjoys. So she heads towards the stone table, dragging Edmund with her. Oh, and she orders the execution of Edmund's siblings and Mr. and Mrs. Beaver. And Edmund does finally start to realize that maybe she's not all that nice after all. Old Ed's a bit of a tool at this point in the story. I hope that's beginning to shine through. Meanwhile, the Beavers realize where Edmund has gone and what he must be up to, and they lead the other children to meet Aslan at the stone table. So they're all coming together at the stone table. Now the children and the Beavers reach the stone table and they meet Aslan and his army. And then the White Witch arrives, and she has a heated conference with Aslan. And she mentions that the deep magic from the dawn of time gives her the right to kill Edmund for his treason. But then Aslan speaks to the witch alone, and on his return, he announces that the witch has renounced her claim on Edmund's life. And at this point, Aslan and his followers move their encampment into the nearby forest. And that evening, Aslan slips away, but Susan and Lucy secretly follow him and watch as he goes to the stone table. And they hide at a distance, and they watch as the witch's minions chain Aslan to the stone table, shave his fur, torture, and mock him. And finally, the witch puts Aslan to death, as they had agreed in their pact to spare Edmund. And the next morning, the two girls are lying beside Aslan's body, mourning and grieving, when they finally realize they have to get up and go back to the others. And as they're walking away, they hear a loud crack, and they turn to see the stone table empty, and Aslan nowhere to be found. But as they come back toward the table, they look up, and in the streaming sunlight of early morning, they see the resurrected Aslan smiling and coming toward them. He explains that he was resurrected by the deeper magic from before the dawn of time, which has the power to reverse the death of a willing victim who has taken the place of a traitor. Tom, do we have a clip of that? It's too good not to watch.
We should go.
She might have interpreted the deep magic differently. That when a willing victim who has committed no treachery is killed in a traitor's stead, the stone table will crack, and even death itself would turn backwards.
We sent the news that you were dead. Peter and Edmund will have gone to war. We have to help them.
We will, dear one, but not alone. Climb on my back. We have far to go and little time to get there. And you may want to cover your ears.
So that's really the pivotal point of the story. After that, Aslan takes the girls to the witch's castle and revives the Narnians that the witch had turned to stone, and they join the Narnian forces battling the witch's army. And of course, the Narnian army prevails, and Aslan kills the witch, and the children are then crowned kings and queens of Narnia. And after a long and happy reign, the children, now adults, go on a hunt for the white stag, who is said to grant the wishes of those who catch it. And the four of them arrive at the lamppost that marks the entrance to Narnia, and they have forgotten about it by that point, and they accidentally pass through the wardrobe and return to England, where they find that they are children again, with no time having passed since their departure. And they tell the whole story to the professor, who believes them and reassures the children that they will return to Narnia one day when they least expect it. The beauty, the absolute genius of The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe lies in C.S. Lewis's ability to tell a story. The little boy who used to sit in the nursery of his family home in Belfast and write stories about the imaginary world of boxing grew up to become the man who sat in his rooms at Oxford University and wrote stories about the imaginary world of Narnia. But even more than that, what makes The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe such an amazing story and such an enduring tale is the way it tells the story of Jesus in a fresh way. He doesn't even change the story, not really. Aslan represents Jesus, that's obvious. The White Witch is Satan and evil. Edmund is representative of humankind. Aslan agreeing to be put to death in Edmund's place despite him having done no wrong himself, and what he calls the deeper magic from before the dawn of time, resurrecting him after death and going on to defeat evil, to save the world, is the story of God's rescue plan, put into motion when God sent Jesus to the world as the Messiah to stand in the gap for us, to bear our burdens and to be bruised for our transgressions and to die that we might live. At various times after the publication of The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, C.S. Lewis was often asked about the Christian imagery in his book. And he always said he didn't start out with the intention of writing a Christian allegory. He said it started from a picture he'd long had in his mind of a fawn in a snowy woods, and it just went from there. Which to me is what makes it even more beautiful and amazing, because it means that even in his freewheeling imagination, his mind still came back to the absolute stunning truth of God's redemption plan. And it wove its way through the wardrobe door and through the snowy woods of Narnia and turned the lion Aslan into a messianic figure who would lay down his guiltless life to save the guilty. The beauty of the story of Jesus is that it can be told from so many angles, from so many vantage points, in so many ways, and it doesn't change its power. It doesn't change its truth. When I was at Central College in McPherson back in the late 80s, I was part of an 8-person drama team called Morning Star Review that traveled around during school breaks to different churches and events throughout the Midwest and part of the South. And we performed a one-act play called Eyes Upon the Cross. And it was the story of the crucifixion of Jesus, the day of the crucifixion. And it was told entirely from the point of view of the people in the crowd. The audience never saw Jesus. We never even saw the cross. All they saw and heard were the people in the crowd who we portrayed. And to this day, it is one of the most powerful productions that I have ever been in. There was rarely a dry eye after our performance. And we were not telling them a story they didn't know. They all knew the story of the crucifixion, but we were telling them the story in a new way, from a new perspective. And it was enough to make them see it through new eyes. When people read The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, or watch the movie, if they're already Christians, if the story of Jesus' death and resurrection is one that they already know and already treasure in their heart, then the story is just another reminder of how amazing it is. But if someone is unsure about taking the step into becoming a follower of Jesus, if they haven't grown up hearing the story, if they aren't sure what salvation is all about, then The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe gives them a creative look at the story in a way that they won't have heard anywhere else. Because the story of the death and the resurrection of Jesus is timeless. And whether it's told through the eyes of the people who were there that day, or whether it's told as a cartoon or a puppet show, or whether we're watching on the silver screen as a giant roaring lion stands in the morning sun in all his resurrected glory, the story of the death and the resurrection of Jesus is always the same. It's the timeless truth of God's plan for our salvation, the plan that was put into motion from the day Adam and Eve fell from glory in the Garden of Eden, as God showed throughout God's refusal to give up on the Israelites, the plan that was foretold by the prophets of the coming Messiah, God's anointed one, by whose stripes we would be healed, who would willingly pay the price for our sins, and whose resurrection would mean life everlasting for all who believe. It's a story more powerful than the roar of a lion, even the mighty Aslan. May it be so. Amen. And now, if you are able, please stand and join us in singing our closing hymn, number 485, To God Be the Glory. Please join us in the parlor for a bit of refreshment and fellowship, and now the charge and benediction. Be steadfast, immovable, always excelling in the work of the Lord, because you know that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.